Hello, my dear students, and everyone who is listening to this lecture. Today I'll be giving a short lecture on Jinbodhi's life and thoughts. I'll be focusing more on his thoughts on religion and state. This is Western political thought for BA political science. Now let's begin with a brief introduction. Jinbodhi was a 16th century French jurist, lawyer, philosopher, historian, and scholar, or political theorist, or political economist, or humanist. Bodin was known primarily for his influential account of sovereignty, which he defined as the absolute and perpetual power of a common world. In other words, Bodin defined sovereignty as the absolute and perpetual power of the state. He was recognized also for his contributions to the philosophy of history, political economy, and religion. Jean Bodin was one of the most influential legal philosophers of the Renaissance, and his theories were heatedly debated both by his contemporaries and by succeeding generations of philosophers. In other words, the writings, the ideas of Jean Bodin was hotly debated or discussed among his contemporaries and even today. Some of his important books include The Six Books of the Commonwealth, or The Six Books of the Republic, simply known as Republic. Second, Method for the Easy Comprehension of History, or simply known as Methodus or Method. And third, Colloquium of the Seven about Secrets of the Sublime. This book was published in the 1683 after his death, and there has been debate whether he was the real author or not. His life. Jean Bodin was born in 1529. Some say he was born in 1530 in the northern part of France. His parents were Guillaume Bodin and Catherine Duterte. There is none of his family or of his early life except that his father was a modestly successful burgher. In other words, his father was a member of the wealthy middle class, probably a tailor. In 1545, he entered the Carmelite order. This Carmelite order is something given by the Catholic Church for further studies. It is sort of a scholarship given to young Catholic youths for further studies. And after he became part of Carmelite order, he was sent to Paris, where he received formidable humanistic education. After his education, he tried to practice at the bar, but he was not successful, so he turned himself instead to legal, historical, and philosophical scholar. In other words, though he was not successful as a lawyer, he became a philosopher. In 1562, he signed the Oath of Catholicity that was required by the Chapter of Notre Dame of Paris. In other words, he was a devout Catholic by faith. Now, let's come to his views on religion. Bodin was a strong exponent of religious toleration. As a person born and brought up during the time of Renaissance, he was in favor of secularism, or he was in favor of separation of state and religion. During his youth, Bodin received Catholic education and remained loyal to the Church until his death. He was born and brought up as a Catholic, and he got Catholic education and remained loyal until his death. Demonstrating his religious conviction, he requested to be buried in a Catholic church. Nevertheless, though he was born and brought up as a Catholic, as he grew up and reached his middle years, he was critical of the church hierarchy and occasionally expressed anti-papal sentiments. Sometimes, as he grew up and became more mature, he started seeing the evils of the church. So he sometimes became so critical of the Catholic Church that some of his biographers have quickly labeled him as a Protestant, but actually he was not a Protestant. During his time, the solidest political fact, or the most serious political issue, was the division of the church, which Bodin thought was irreparable, and was convinced that no single sect could either convince or coerce the others. In other words, During his time, the church was divided so much so that Bodin thought it would be impossible to unite again. In other words, the Protestant will not be able to absorb the Catholic faith, and the Catholic faith will not be able to convince the Protestant to join them. So, since unification of the church was no longer possible, Bodin preferred every religion to coexist in order to hold together the French nationality. He was a nationalist, he was a patriot, so he wants his country to be united, or he wants to hold together the French nationality, even though they are divided in terms of religion. Bodin was not a pure Protestant, but rather a critic of the Roman Catholic clergy, its hierarchy, and some of its doubtful religious practices. Bodin was rather a fervent believer in the true religion. He was not much interested in Protestant or Catholic faith, rather he believed in true religion, which he considered nothing other than looking to God with a purified spirit. His criticisms on all religious sects were so balanced that nobody knows whether he was a real Catholic or Protestant. In other words, he criticized both Catholic and Protestant equally and in a balanced manner that many people were confused whether he was a Catholic or Protestant. Now let's come to his ideas or his view on state. If we are going to discuss about his ideas on state, we have to first understand his idea on family. According to Bodin, family formed the natural unit, or in other words, family is a natural institution that become a natural unit for all other communities or societies or associations, including the state. Family is always the foundation on which other human associations are formed. A family, according to Bodin, consists of a father, a mother, children, and servants, along with their common property. In other words, in a family, there is a father, mother, children, and servants, and apart from that, they all collectively own common property. Property is a natural right, which is attached to the family, according to Zinbodin. Many associations of families arise for common defense and for the pursuit of mutual advantages, and form villages, cities, and corporations of various kinds. And when these associations or organizations are united by a sovereign authority, a state is formed. In other words, according to Zinbodin, when many families come together for a common purpose or for common defense, they form a village, a city, or a corporation, or different forms of human associations. But when all these associations, including the village, the cities, and the corporations, are united by one sovereign authority, that kind of unification of all human associations of a particular territory by a sovereign authority is known as a state. In other words, a state is formed only when a sovereign authority unites all these human associations under one government. In a paterfamily, the father has the complete control over the person's property and lives of his children. According to Zinbodin, in a paterfamily, or in a patriarchal kind of family, the father completely controls everything, including the property and the children. Now, Bodin defines state as a lawful government of several households and of their common possessions with sovereign power. In other words, a state is nothing but coming together of so many households or so many families under a lawful government which have sovereign power. When so many families or so many human associations come together under one lawful government with the power of sovereignty, then that kind of association is called state. The word lawful here signifies just or justice, or in accordance with the law of nature, and distinguish the state from a lawless associations like a band of robbers. A band of robbers also come together, but they are not organized by a lawful government, or they don't possess sovereign power, because state possesses sovereign power under lawful government, but a band of robbers doesn't possess those things. When Bodin defined the state as a government of households, it is the paterfamilias who become a citizen when he steps outside his house and acts in concert with other heads of families. A well ordered state cannot exist until a sovereign power is recognized and that the units of which it is composed are families. Now, a proper state or a well ordered state can exist only when there is sovereign power, which is recognized by the members of the society and families as the unit of that society. In other words, when so many families form a certain larger society with the power of sovereignty, only under that circumstances a well ordered state can be formed. The state, according to him, has a soul as well as a body, and the soul is higher, though the need of the body is more immediately pressing. In other words, the state has both soul and body. Whereas the soul is more important, or it is higher in the hierarchy, sometimes the need of the body is more immediately filled. Bodin writes that there are only three types of state or commonwealth. State and commonwealth are more or less the same. Now, according to Jean Bodin, there are three types of commonwealth. First is monarchy. Monarchy means the rule of one person. Second is aristocracy, or the rule of few people. And third is the democracy, or the rule of the majority or all the people. So there are only three types of state: monarchy, aristocracy, and democracy, according to Bodin. To him, there cannot be more than three types of state, but there can be many types of government. In other words, one particular type of state can be governed by different type of government. Bodin holds that sovereignty cannot be divided, because it is the sole authority or the sole power of the state, and it cannot be divided. This power of sovereignty may reside in one person or a group of persons, but it cannot be divided. Sovereignty has an impact upon both the internal affairs of the state as well as its external affairs. Sovereignty can affect the internal affairs of the state and also the external affairs. The internal affairs in its existence or exercise of full political power within the state, or externally, it can affect its conduct of war and international relations. In other words, there is internal and external sovereignty. Internal sovereignty means extreme or absolute power of the state, and external sovereignty means the independence of the state in regards to other nations. Now, the distinction between the form of state and the forms of government are essential for understanding the differences between royal monarchies, despotic monarchies, and tyrannical monarchies. Bodin remarked that all monarchies, aristocracies, and popular states are either tyrannical, despotic, or legitimate. In other words, every type of state has either tyrannical rule, despotic rule, or legitimate rule. The difference between despotism and tyrannical is crucial, according to Jean Bodin. According to him, despotism is legitimate and sometimes legal. In a despotic monarchy, the prince becomes lord of the goods and persons of his subjects by law of arms and lawful war, and govern them as the master of a family. In other words, despotism is always legitimate. It may or may not be legal, but it is always legitimate. It uses force or arms or war, but all those are lawful ones. And in despotism, the people are governed as the member of the family looked after by the head of the family. In other words, when we talk about tyranny, it is always illegitimate, illegal, and contrary to natural and divine laws. Tyranny is one in which the sovereign ruler violates the laws of God or the laws of nature, oppresses his subjects, and treats their private property as his own. Tyranny is not just illegitimate or illegal, but also violate the law of nature or the law of God, and often oppress, subjugate his own subjects, and treats their family property or private property as his own. The family is the sphere of private, the state is that of the public or common. In other words, the state and the family is different in such a way that the family is for the private sphere and the state is for the common or the public sphere. Property belongs to the family and sovereignty belongs to the prince and his magistrates. Bodin eliminated the mandate of God, which the theory of divine right offer as a foundation for the king's authority, though he did not fill the gap with a natural explanation. During those days, the divine right of kingship or the theory of divine right was so common. Under this theory, a king or a ruler has to be mandated by God. Unless a person is mandated by God, he cannot become a ruler. And then, who is going to decide the mandate of God? Because God practically don't speak to human beings. So who will represent this voice of God? Here, it is the church, or it is the priest, particularly the Pope, who will claim that he is the messenger of God to anoint a particular king or ruler as having the divine right to rule. But Bodin, as a secularist or as a realist, was against this kind of mandate of God for a ruler. So he eliminated the mandate of God, which the divine theory or theory of divine right offer as a foundation for the king's authority. But he was not able to explain this natural explanation. Dear students, we will wind up here for today. And in the next lecture, we will focus specifically on Jean Bodhi's view on sovereignty. Sovereignty is very interesting, and it is in fact the most important contribution of Jean Bodhi to political theory. So for today, I hope you understand a little bit about Jean Bodhi's personal life, his view on religion, and most importantly, his view on state. Let me repeat a little bit again. Jean Bodin believed that family is a natural institution and it is the unit or the natural unit of all human associations, including state. Now, how state are formed? State are formed when a group of families come together and form villages, cities, and corporations or different associations, and when all these human associations are united by a sovereign authority, then a state came into existence. In other words, state is a collection of many villages, many families, or many associations, or many corporations, whatever name you would like to call. So when so many families or so many human associations, different levels of human associations are united under one sovereign power, that is a state. State is different from other associations or other human gatherings in such that state has the power of sovereignty, or state enjoys the power of sovereign authority, and other human associations does not have this power. Thank you so much. Thank you for today. Take care till we meet again for the next lecture.